subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
Hi, I'm Ayaz Maimon. Cricket often rides on this cliche that it's a game of glorious uncertainties. And the last day of the WTC final, India versus New Zealand, showed exactly why. Who would have thought that New Zealand would win this match? Yes, theoretically, that was a possibility. In fact, a greater possibility than India winning the match. That seemed very remote. A tie was obviously the rarest of rare results that could have been got. The most likely result seemed to be a draw because there was just not enough time remaining in the match, or so everyone thought. And hey, you know what happened? New Zealand won this match by 8 wickets. It's a thumping win. It's an 8 wicket margin. And it just kind of upset the prognostications that had taken place before the match. All the complaints at a time when there's so much rain, or couldn't it have been deferred by a few days, this match. 2 days were lopped off. Two entire days were lopped off from this test match. Thankfully, there was a provision of a sixth day, a reserve day, which helped produce a result. But even then, it seemed very difficult for either team to force the issue. Given the strengths of the two teams, you know, there had been a battle of attrition for most of the days, days when play was possible. But on the last day, it was not attrition that helped India overcome New Zealand. In fact, there was no attrition. India succumbed quite easily. And it all happened in the first half hour when Kyle Jameson, 6'8" tall, he's been the hero. He had been the hero of the first innings, taking 5 for 31. And he became the hero again on this day when he got the wickets of Virat Kohli, the most crucial. In fact, in my opinion, the fell blow, because you lose Virat Kohli, captain of the team, the best batsman of the team, then it sucks out the confidence in the Indian dressing room. And then shortly after that, Cheteshwar Pujara, who otherwise is known to kind of stick around like the Rock of Gibraltar, it didn't help. It didn't happen. Kyle Jameson prized him out also. And then when Ajinkya Rahane fell, that was more or less kaput. I mean, yes, Rishabh Pant was there to strike a few blows, hold out a glimmer of hope, but it just got worse and worse. Every time there was a 10, 15, 20 run partnership, it seemed that India might overcome the crisis, but then they went into a worse one because the wicket fell. What we saw on the last day is in a way telling as to how the two teams performed. New Zealand picked up 8 wickets on the last day. All 8 wickets being taken by the pace bowlers, defending 139 is what New Zealand needed to get. Not a single wicket was taken by the Indian fast bowlers. That showed the disparity, in my opinion, between the two bowling attacks and how they responded. The bowlers responded to the pitch, to the challenge of the situation. Not that the Indian bowlers bowled badly. Shami was excellent again in the second innings. Bumrah had a sharp spell. Ishant was accurate. But the two wickets were picked up by Ravichandran Ashwin. Now, India had a task on the last day of trying to bat out enough time, enough overs to not leave New Zealand the chance of winning this match, which meant, and which I had mentioned earlier, that they had to play out about 2 sessions or get a lead of around 180, 190, perhaps 200. That would make it difficult, if not impossible, for New Zealand to chase the target for victory. It didn't happen because I think in these conditions, the inadequacies of the technical inadequacies of the Indian batting showed up. And that's a strong comment to make, because you're talking of players like, you know, before Virat and Pujara started on the last day, there was Rohit Sharma, there was Shubman Gill, then of course Virat Kohli, Cheteshwar Pujara, Ajinkya Rahane, Rishabh Pant. He's a kind of a free spirit, so I'm not including the technical aspect over here of his batting abilities. But these 5, at least, you know, the top order, let themselves down. The Kohli, Pujara and Rahane, soft dismissals. They were not worthy of taking wickets in such a tight situation. It was the pressure of the situation, and they were hustled into wrong strokes. That's the quality of bowling that we saw from New Zealand, from Kyle Jameson, then from Neil Wagner, the way he bowled, to use a 50, 60, 45, 50 over a ball, which has gone a little soft, come and keep bowling those short pitch deliveries on the leg stump to Ravindra Jadeja, and with great accuracy, not giving him movement, you know, facility for movement, no footwork for Jadeja, and then smartly coming and angling one across his body to take the edge and be caught behind. So that was the quality of the seam attack we saw from New Zealand. And the variety, swing bowler Southee came and polished off the tail. And, you know, I've talked about Jamieson. It was a virtuoso performance from him in this match, and he was rightly named the man of the match. Trent Bolt, and, you know, in combination, they were far ahead of the Indian combination. Now, what really happened is that, you know, when you made 134, when the target is 139 in 53 overs, it's reachable. You can't defend for too long unless you pick up 4-5 wickets, which didn't happen. And also, I think what came back to bite the Indian team was the 32-run lead. Now, even I thought that it was psychologically important, but maybe not decisive. However, it proved to be extremely crucial because 32 runs more in these bowling conditions, they would have forced the Kiwi batsmen to take a few more risks early on and maybe lose their wickets. It didn't happen. Now, if one has to trace back as to what caused India's debacle, because remember, it is a debacle in many ways. Losing the toss, was it so crucial? Yes, I mean, losing the toss was tough. They, you know, on the opening day, both teams would have wanted to field first, suss out the pitch. India went in. The conditions not good at all. The bowlers bowling well. However, I don't think that was so crucial in the final outcome. Losing the toss, India were 146 for 3 when the first day's play was possible. First day was washed out, but this was the second day. And they were poised to make 280, about 300. If that was the story, then this match could have panned out completely differently. It didn't happen because the next morning, India collapsed. Losing the toss was critical in the first session of play or the first day of play or the first two sessions of play. India passed that with, you know, fairly impressively, I thought. And then things started happening. Was it the team combination which was wrong? You know, now in hindsight, you might say, why did we need an extra spinner or an extra fast bowler could have helped? Maybe. But that's now, in hindsight, vision is 20-20. So all kinds of things can come up, theories. But remember, Ashwin got 4 wickets in the match. Jadeja didn't bowl too badly. Let's give credit to the New Zealand batsmen. You know, they coped with the pressure better. They coped with the demands of the situation better. They coped with the challenges posed by the pitch better. In the first innings, they got ahead. They took the lead, 32-run lead. Narrow lead, as we know, but now became crucial. And in the second innings, they played out so sensibly the Indian attack that you can't say that the combination really hurt India. You needed that combination to have batting depth. Virat Kohli made the point that perhaps if they had a fast bowling all-rounder like a Hardik Pandya, they would have had a fourth fast bowler instead of spinner. Point taken, but Hardik wasn't there. So in the context of this match and the players available, I thought they chose the best team. Now, what made a difference? I just picked out or plucked out some stats. The last 4 batsmen of India in the first innings made 12 runs. The last 4 in the first innings. In the second innings, they made 14 runs. The New Zealand batsmen, in contrast, the last 4, you're talking of the tail, lower, real lower order and the tail, they put on 59 runs. So it shows that the New Zealand tail also, you know, to wag, and therefore got them the vital lead and help them get the psychological advantage. This is a big thing to consider for India, especially in conditions overseas where the top order might be a little wobbly. There's no runs coming from the bottom 3 or 4, you know, from Ishant, Shami and Bumrah. It's difficult to even expect 10-12 runs, and that becomes a problem in a tight contest. But the biggest problem, in my opinion, was the failure of the top order. Now, you're talking of a batting lineup of revered names. Rohit Sharma, Shubman Gill is a youngster but touted as the next big thing. Chiteshwar Pujara, Virat Kohli, Ajinkya Rahane, and of course Rishabh Pant, who played his part in the second innings. But these guys, runs were expected from them. When the situation and the conditions are so challenging, you expect these guys with 7,000 runs and 6,000 runs and mighty averages to come good. It didn't happen. In contrast, New Zealand in the first innings Conway batted well, Latham batted well in the second innings. Williamson, Ross Taylor, all their experience to the fore, they brought and steered their team to a win. Imagine if Williamson and or Taylor had fallen early, you know, it could have got very, very tight even for New Zealand. But these guys hung in there, great temperament, patience, and not to forget, a lot of skills. So, at the end of the day, you know, hats off to New Zealand. You have to accept that they've been exceptional in this two-year cycle. They've got, it's a very cohesive team. It's played well. The resources are complementary to each other. And, you know, just the approach was fantastic. The structuring of their game plan and the execution of their game plan was top rate. And I think they were deserving champions. Great to see a team like New Zealand win, because it just opens up the sport to that much more opportunities and possibilities. India still to, or Virat Kohli, still to get his hand on an ICC trophy. Look, it's he's had a few opportunities, the 2019 World Cup, the 2017 Champions Trophy. He put up a good front. I think he took the defeat well, but somewhere it'll be hurting him that this was an opportunity which could have been exploited far better. It didn't happen.